Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Indo News Analysis for the day 18th February 2021. These are the list of news articles that will be discussed in today's analysis. They are given here along with the page number of different editions. Now let us move on to the first news article. This article discusses about the deteriorating human rights situation that is happening in Sri Lanka. So in this discussion, we will see about the background for this violation. The syllabus for this article is highlighted below. You all would have heard about the Sri Lankan civil war that lasted for 26 years, about which we will be seeing now. See, in Sri Lanka, the ethnic, religious and linguistic distinctions are essentially the same. And there are three ethnic groups in Sri Lanka, namely Sinhalese, Muslim and Tamil. And among them, Sinhalese account for nearly three-fourths, that is around 74.9% of the population. And the Tamil people in Sri Lanka, they comprise of two groups. One is Sri Lankan Tamils, who are the minority people since they constitute only 11.2% of the population. And these people, that is these Sri Lankan minorities, are the long-settled descendants from southeastern part of India. Another group of Indian Tamils are the recent immigrants from southeastern India, and most of them are migrant workers who were brought to Sri Lanka under the British rule. Remember, Sinhalese, they tend to be Buddhist and Tamils tend to be Hindu, which means there are significant linguistic and religious divisions. And additionally, Sinhalese, they dominate in western and central Sri Lanka, whereas the Tamils dominate in the northern and eastern parts of Sri Lanka. Historically, there have been a power dispute between these communities or groups, and this was further aggravated during the British rule in Sri Lanka. Note, the British rule in Sri Lanka lasted until 1948, and the Tamil dominance was witnessed in Sri Lanka during this period. But after 1948, this situation changed dramatically and Sinhalese started to gain more power. And Sinhalese, they passed acts that effectively deprived the rights of Tamils. An example for this would be the Sinhala Only Act. So this act, it made Sinhala as the only official language of Sri Lanka, and it also created barriers for Tamil people who were trying to access government services and who were seeking public employment. Similar acts were passed that discriminated and marginalized the Sri Lankans' Tamil minorities. As a result, some Tamils, they responded with the idea of Tamil Eelam. See, this Tamil Eelam is the idea of a separate state that was demanded by the Tamils in Sri Lanka. And this idea, it gave rise to the Liberation Tigers of Tamil Eelam, which is also called as LTTE. And this LTTE was founded to fight for Tamil rights. And this LTTE, they became an uncompromising group and they were inspired by Che Guevara and his guerrilla warfare tactics. So this situation led to a conflict between the Sri Lankan government and the LTTE, which eventually escalated in a civil war in the year 1983 when J.R. Jayawardhan was the president of Sri Lanka. And this president, that is J.R. Jayawardhan, was succeeded by Rana Singhe Premadasa. And you should note here that amidst the war, LTTE, they assassinated two world leaders, namely Indian Prime Minister Rajiv Gandhi. Then later, Mahinda Rajapakse, he was elected as a president for the period between 2005 to 2015. And this person, that is Mahinda Rajapakse, was known for strong stance against the LTTE group. In 2009, the war ended when Sri Lankan government announced that they killed the LTTE leader, and it is said that between 70,000 to 80,000 people have been killed in the war. During its final phase, brutal violence and human rights violations were carried out by both sides, that is both by the Sri Lankan government as well as the LTTE. And even the UN notes that there was persistent and grave human rights violations and abuses by both parties. And these violations include extrajudicial killings, widespread enforced disappearances, then arbitrary detention, then torture and sexual violence that affected the Sri Lankans from all communities. Even after the war came to an end, the situation was not found to improve and a large portion of Tamil population still remains displaced. And instances of torture and enforced disappearances also continues to exist even now. So many of these tortures and abuses happened during Rajapakse's tenure, where the critics of the government were murdered, tortured and they were forcibly made to disappear. Further, the Prevention of Terrorism Act of Sri Lanka was continued to be used by the government disproportionately against the members of Tamil community. So now we will see as to what did the international community do in order to address the scenario. See, various UN HRC resolutions were adopted and many of them called for an independent international investigation into alleged war crimes that was committed by both parties. And one such landmark resolution was adopted in the year 2015 after new president, that is Maithripala Sirisena, was elected in Sri Lanka. This resolution is known as Resolution 30-1 and it was co-sponsored by Sri Lanka. This resolution, it set out detailed steps for Sri Lanka to pursue accountability and reconciliation and also the security sector reform in order to prevent future abuses. But unfortunately, in the elections of 2019, Gotabaya Rajapakse was elected as the president. See, this person, Gotabaya Rajapakse, is the brother of Mahinda Rajapakse. February 2020, Sri Lanka withdrew from this resolution 30-1, stating that it will carry out its own inclusive, domestically designed and executive reconciliation and accountability process. Further, the human rights situation worsened since Gotabaya became the president, and the author notes that abuses against the Tamils are increasing. And these have been documented by a recent report by the UN Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. And as per the report of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, the report is highly critical of the continued impunity in Sri Lanka. That is, that it criticizes that still many are exempted from punishment for conducting war crimes. And the report also highlights the backsliding on human rights, the increased militarization, the intimidation of civil society by government, etc. For example, there is a severe militarization of civilian government functions in Gotabaya's rule, where 31 entities, including police, have been brought under the oversight of the Ministry of Defense. And further, many serving or former military or intelligence personnel have been appointed to key administrative posts. See, now here the issue is many of these officials have been alleged of war crimes and on crimes against humanity during the final years of the civil war as per the UN reports. So this shows that the current Sri Lankan government is completely disregarding its accountability to war crimes. So the report calls for the International Criminal Court to investigate the commission of international crimes during the civil war. And as a conclusion, the authors suggest UNHRC to pass a new resolution in order to protect the vulnerable minority communities in Sri Lanka in its upcoming session. With this, we will move on to discuss the next news article. Now let us take up this editorial article, which was written by a former member of the Planning Commission. Here, the author talks about the inability of the Indian state to take care of its poorest citizens. Now, let us discuss this article in detail. The syllabus relevant for this article is highlighted below. First, the author tells that the weakness of the Indian state to care for its poorer citizens is not a failure of the present government only, or in that case, the previous governments, but the weakness is a part and parcel of our system itself. So now the author talks about the three pillars on which a strong state is founded. They are the support from the people, a strong administrative machinery to provide stability and to deliver public services, and finally, the managerial ability to shape and to implement change. First, let us see how the support of people helps in building a strong state. See, according to the author, strong support of people or citizens is very much essential for the government to be successful. Now, how this support is garnered? The author notes that generally this is done with the help of a shared identity. Here, he quotes a famous political scientist who pointed out that builders of strong states have integrated people around a shared entity, and this shared entity can be ethnic, racial, or in terms of religion. He further says that people's identity is not formed by legal constitutions, but it is the people who give these strong leaders, who unite them around their shared identity, the liberty to change constitutional structures. This is because they are convinced that their leaders do it for the betterment of citizens. But here, the trouble is that it can lead to dictatorship regimes. And another issue is that the shared identity can be built only in a state where less diversity exists. For example, we have China, where there are no much ethnic or religious differences, and this helps the leaders in China to rule the people in a dictatorship model by bringing them together under a shared identity and gaining their trust. But can the same happen with India? The answer is no, it's not possible. Since it is very hard to unite Indians around a shared ethnic or religious identity because we are a nation with n number of diversity, be it in terms of race, religion, culture, etc. And in addition to this, there exists a deep-rooted caste system which is embedded in our society with entrenched caste divisions. So according to the author, if Indians must be united to support a strong state, it should be around a modern and an inclusive idea of India as per the dreams of our constitution, instead of trying to force a majoritarian identity which will only divide citizens of India further and it will eventually lead to the weakening of the state. Second, he talks about the stability of bureaucracy. In this regard, let us see what role the bureaucracy has got to play in helping build a strong state. See here, the author talks about the role that stable professional civil services have played in the formation of strong states. For example, in Han China, the Ottoman Empire, France and Japan. And in case of India, we inherited the iron frame of civil services from Britain. Here, this iron frame denotes the stability. Now, what is the problem with this model of bureaucracy? See, we should know that the term bureaucracy is often used as a pejorative for the structures. Calling a public employee as a bureaucrat is not usually intended to compliment that individual. I mean, this is often used as a sarcasm. Here we should know that the colonial bureaucracy which we inherited has created numerous rules and laws that must be followed. The problem with this is that this complicates the workloads that people must endure, and we often hear the term red tapeism. For example, when you submit a file for clearance, it runs through many hands for a long time and then it finally lies on a table with dust accumulated on it. And in the meanwhile, you will be forced to visit the offices many times, and sometimes the employees even ask for a bribe for your file to be taken. Now, according to the author, stability of bureaucracy is required to build a strong state. But the issue with this colonial bureaucracy is that it was merely designed to provide stability and compliance with rules. And it was not equipped to absorb change, which means it is not adaptive of the changes that occur in the society in the course of evolution. And according to the author, the third requirement of a good developmental state is a flexible and reformative bureaucracy which can adapt to changes in the society. So in this regard, simultaneous management of both change and stability is necessary for the evolution of good states and societies. Here, when we tell this, it means that both changes and stability should be balanced. And as the author says, unmanaged change can cause chaos, while too little change consolidates or it makes the system more resistive to changes. In this regard, to substantiate his view on stability versus change for a good governance, the author takes the example of capitalism versus socialism and markets versus governments. By the end of the 20th century, capitalism and markets were positioned in the public imagination as the prime movers of economic growth or the supporters of change. And socialists and governments were considered as resistors to change and as retarders of progress. The capitalists came to be known as wealth creators, giving governments just the role of redistributors. This led to a popular pro-capitalist slogan that wealth must be created before it can be redistributed, and this means that there should be less government when countries are poor and more freedom for large private capitalistic wealth creators. And nowadays, we can see that the governments are bringing capitalists and consultants from the private sector to assist them and help the state to run more like a business corporation to improve efficiency and effectiveness of the system. But here too, there is a problem. It is that the capitalistic ideology has a utility maximizing behavior, and they do not think like socialists who are concerned about the condition of the people who are waiting for wealth to trickle down to them. See, the primary goal of private corporations are mostly profit maximization, and they don't work with intention to improve the life conditions of the poor. Whereas the role of the state or the government is to perform primarily for its poorest citizens, economic growth to be equitable and sustainable. So the author opines that the leaders of states must ensure that all citizens, even those who cannot afford it, have got good health and education. And in this regard, what India needs is the public servants who devote their lives to the care of citizens, unlike private sector employees who devote their lives to maximize the profits of their employers. So the author concludes that India must build a strong and good state which works for the welfare of the citizens, and this requires political leaders who can unite all Indians into one India, the carers of good public managers, to build and run services for all citizens equitably, and business leaders who are not just wealth creators for themselves but creators of opportunities for millions of Indians to earn and create wealth for themselves too. With this information, let us move on to the next news article. Now look at this article. This article says that advocate Nikita Jacob, who is one of the accused in the Toolkit case, has been granted a transit anticipatory bail for a period of 3 weeks. So in this context, let us discuss in detail about the bail, its different types, etc. The syllabus for this news article is given below. Now coming to the news article, see, the right to liberty is a natural right as well as a fundamental right of an individual. But when a person is reasonably suspected to have committed an offense, then the machinery of law will be set in motion to arrest him and to bring him to trial, and also to punish him if he or she is found guilty. This concept of bail flows from the right to liberty, which is sanctified as one of the fundamental rights in the Constitution of India in Article 21. So, a bail connotes the process of procuring the release of an accused who is charged with certain offence by ensuring his future attendance in the court for trial and by compelling him to remain within the jurisdiction of the court. So you should also know that Section 436 to 439 of Chapter 33 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, it deals with various provisions related to bails and bonds. Another provision which deals with the same concept is Section 167 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, and it is generally termed as a default bail. So while considering the aspect of bail, both these provisions are to be studied in the context of each other. Broadly speaking, there are three categories of bail. They are bail in bailable offences, bail in non-bailable offences, and anticipatory bail. When you look at Section 436 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, you can find that its provision deals with bail in bailable offences. And under this section, bail is the right of a person who has been accused for commission of offence which is bailable in nature. This provision makes it a mandatory duty for the police official as well as the court to release the accused on bail if the offence alleged against such a person is bailable in nature. See, a bailable offence means an offence which is shown as bailable in the first schedule of the Code of Criminal Procedure, or any offences that is mentioned in the first schedule of the Code of Criminal Procedure is considered to be a bailable offence, or a bailable offence can be one which is made bailable by any other law for the time being in force. Contrary to this, non-bailable offence means any other offence other than these bailable offences. Under Section 437, when a person is accused of or suspected of the commission of any non-bailable offence, then the person can be arrested or detained without a warrant, and he or she should be brought before a court which is other than a high court or a session court, and on bringing, he or she may be released on bail. But this provision has got some exceptions, that is, such person shall not be released under certain grounds. Say for example, if there appear reasonable grounds for believing that he or she has been guilty of an offence which is punishable with death or imprisonment for life, then such person will not be released under bail. Note that Section 438 of the Criminal Procedure Code deals with anticipatory bail. See, this anticipatory bail is nothing but a bail in the event of arrest when any person has a reason to believe that he or she may be arrested of an accusation of having committed a non-bailable offence. So in such a case, he or she may apply to the High Court or Sessions Court for direction that in the event of arrest, he or she shall be released on bail. So therefore, the said powers are exclusively vested with the Court, Sessions Court and High Court. And for considering the application for anticipatory bail, the prerequisite condition is that the offence should be non-bailable. And the kind of bail that is mentioned in this news article is a transit anticipatory bail. See, a transit anticipatory bail is sought when a case against a person has been or is likely to be filed in a state that is different from the one in which he or she is likely to be arrested. So therefore, the purpose for this anticipatory bail is to allow bail for the person so that they can approach the appropriate court in the state in which the case has been filed for anticipatory bail. So with this, we have come to the end of this news article. Let us move on to the next news article. The news article mentions that the Securities and Exchange Board of India, or SEBI, has approved some proposals including for relaxing minimum public offer norms. Here, know that a public offering is the sale of equity shares or other financial instruments such as bonds to the public in order to raise capital. So in this context, let us have a very brief understanding about SEBI. See, it was established in 1992 in accordance with the provisions of the Securities and Exchange Board of India Act of 1992. So it is a statutory body and its basic functions are to protect the interest of investors in securities, to promote the development of securities market, and to regulate the securities market and to deal with matters related to it. Its functions also include regulating the business in stock exchanges and any other securities markets, and registering and regulating the working of stock brokers, sub brokers, share transfer agents, and other intermediaries. Some of the other functions of SEBI are given here for your reference. Now let's see about its composition. See, it consists of a chairman and 8 members according to the act, and among the members, 2 members are from the officials of the Ministry of Finance and the Ministry of Corporate Affairs. 1 member is from among the officials of RBI. See, these 3 members are nominated by RBI. The remaining 5 members and the chairman are appointed by the central government. Now look at this article titled Rahul accuses Prime Minister of destroying the institution of the Lieutenant Governor's office. So we know that former Puducherry Lieutenant Governor Kiran Bedi has had frequent issues with the elected government, and recently she was removed from that post by the Union government. So in this context, let us discuss the powers of the Governor and the Lieutenant Governor. Know that Articles 239 to 241 in Part 8 of the Constitution deal with the Union Territories. Even though all the Union Territories belong to one category, there is no uniformity when it comes to their administrative system. And every Union Territory is administered by the President, who is acting through an administrator appointed by him. As we all know, the Union Territories of Puducherry and Delhi are provided with a Legislative Assembly and a Council of Ministers headed by a Chief Minister. But the establishment of such institutions in the Union Territories does not diminish the supreme control of the President and the Parliament over them. An administrator of a Union Territory is an agent of the President and is not the head of a state like a governor. And the President can specify the designation of an administrator. The designation can be that of a Lieutenant Governor or a Chief Commissioner or an administrator. Know that for Puducherry and Delhi, it is Lieutenant Governor. The President can also appoint the Governor of a state as the administrator of an adjoining Union Territory. In that capacity, the Governor is to act independently of his Council of Ministers. Now, let us differentiate between a Governor and a Lieutenant Governor. Know that the powers a governor has in the state they administer is equal to that of the President. That is, they can appoint chief ministers, ministers, state election commissioner, and the judges of the district court. They also serve as chancellors of all the universities in the state. And similarly, the governor can also dissolve the state assembly if they see the need. And if in case the assembly is not in session, then the governor can also promulgate ordinances. And when you come to the Lieutenant Governor, he also has got the similar powers. Only 3 Union Territories, that is the Union Territory of Andaman and Nicobar, Delhi and Puducherry, have got Lieutenant Governors. And these powers are in place to ensure checks and balances for the state government and its functioning. Here, we shall know an observation made by the Supreme Court in 2017, which said that the Lieutenant Governor of Delhi to be having more powers when compared to that of the Governor of a state. This is because he does not have to listen to the advice of the Council of Ministers. And in the case of Delhi, since portfolios like land, police and public order, they fall under the domain of the center, of which the Lieutenant Governor is a representative, he holds more powers than a governor.
Now let us move on to the prelims practice questions.
Look at this prelims practice questions. The union territories are administered by the president through an administrator appointed by him. And the administrators of which of the following union territories are designated as lieutenant governors? So as seen earlier in the discussion, only three union territories, that is union territories of Andaman and Nicobar, Delhi and Puducherry, have got the lieutenant governors. So when you look into the options, you find that Andaman and Nicobar and Puducherry are present. So therefore, the right answer is option A. See, as you know, union territories are administered by the president, acting to a such extent as he thinks fit through an administrator who is appointed by him. And the administrators of Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Delhi and Puducherry, are designated as lieutenant governors. And the governor of Punjab is concurrently the administrator of Chandigarh, and the administrator of Dadar and Nagar Haveli is concurrently the administrator of Daman and Diu. And when you look at Lakshadweep, it has got a separate administrator. So, since the question asks us to identify the union territories with the lieutenant governors, right option is option A, that is 1 and 2 only. Now look at the question. Consider the following statements with reference to Securities and Exchange Board of India. Statement 1. It is a quasi-judicial body. Statement 2. It was established under the provisions of the Reserve Bank of India Act of 1934 with an aim to protect the interest of investors in securities. Now we have to identify the correct statement. See, first statement is correct, as we know that SEBI is a quasi-judicial authority too. It has the authority to deliver judgments related to fraud and other unethical practices in terms of the securities market. And this helps to ensure fairness, transparency and accountability in the securities market. If you take the second statement, it is incorrect, as it was established in 1992 in accordance with the provisions of the Securities and Exchange Board of India Act of 1992. So therefore, the right option is option A, that is 1 only. Let's take up this prelims practice question regarding anticipatory bail. Which of the following conditions may be imposed by the Sessions Court while granting the bail to an accused person? Option 1 is, the persons shall make themselves available for the interrogation by police officer as and when required. Option 2, the person shall not directly or indirectly make any inducement to any witness. Option 3, the person shall not leave India without previous permission of the court. See, Section 438 Clause 2 of the Criminal Procedure Code provides that the High Court or the Sessions Court may also impose some conditions while granting the application. And these conditions include that the person shall make himself available for the interrogation by police officer as and when required, and that the person shall not directly or indirectly make any inducement, threats or promises to any witness, and similarly a person shall not leave India without previous permission of the court. And since the question asks for the right option, the option is option D, that is 1, 2 and 3.
The list of mains practice questions is given here. You can write your answers and post it in the comment box below.
With this, we have come to the end of this news analysis. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates regarding UPSC Civil Services preparation.